Yeah, we begin now. Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome everyone to the 14th Belief series. I hope everyone can hear me. Request, other than the panelists, everybody to be on mute, video and audio wise.
Okay.
I'll take a moment to briefly introduce our panelists to everyone. We have three panelists today, Ravi Chellam, Seema Mundoli, and Lakshmikant. Ravi Chellam is currently the CEO of MetaString Foundation. He has also worked with the Greenpeace International as executive director before, and has also worked, his main work in conservation has been on Asiatic lions. Seema Mundoli is currently a professor at Azim Premji University. Although she started as started a corporate career, she is currently involved in a lot of conservation and restoration activities. Lakshmikant is a member of the awareness, state level awareness committee of the Karnataka Pollution Control Board. Welcome everybody. I'd like to begin with Ravi Chellam. The common person understands a lot of bustling wildlife, but what should he know specifically when you mean there is good biodiversity? How would you measure it? How is it defined to a layperson?
The easiest way to look at biodiversity is nature in its myriad and varied forms, starting from unicellular or even viruses and going to the biggest mammals like blue whale and the biggest trees. Somehow our perception of wildlife is typically large mammals and reptiles which can attack and kill us. I mean, that's the way we view wildlife, something which is dangerous and can cause harm to us. But the ecological definition of wildlife is all forms of life occurring in the wild. So it spans quite a wide range, and it definitely includes plants. Most of the public's understanding of wildlife is it either has to be a snake or a crocodile or an elephant or a tiger or a bear. Plants are never seen as wildlife. And biodiversity, of course, operates in multiple levels, starting from genes and so on and so forth. But that need not be something that the public necessarily needs to engage with. But as long as they view that variability, the diversity, and the multiple forms it takes, and acknowledge that they are all part of nature. And in many ways, all of them have arrived on this earth, evolved on this earth, much before the first human. They almost always predate human presence. In that sense, we are Johnny come lately to the earth. And we need to, as in general Indian culture, we say we respect the elderly. We need to respect all other species there, because they're almost always elderly to us.
Okay, but still, whatever, if you don't put a metric to it, how is the cry that the biodiversity is dwindling to be taken? I mean, by what metric has it decreased?
It's very simple to visualize. Human beings can build multi-storied apartments and cram ourselves into smaller and smaller spaces. Most plants, animals require certain ecological conditions and can only survive up to a particular density. Much as you would like it, you can't pack animals into multi-storied apartments. The minute they reach what is called as their ecological carrying capacity, animals will have to move. Plants will not survive. So if you destroy habitats, which typically human beings do, either by things like large-scale mining or even atomic bomb testing and so on, and what climate change is doing slowly but cumulatively and now synergistically acting, and one of the kind of results is, of course, the pandemic that we are enduring. It is very clear, you go to a habitat, whether it is degraded or not, whether it's fragmented or not. If it is not degraded, if there is no active poaching, then the chances for biodiversity to survive is good. If it is fragmented, if it is degraded, and if poaching is going on, you don't need a metric. I mean, it is just very, very clear. Because this obsession with numbers often leads us to somehow not focus on the real thing that need to focus. If tiger population is increasing, but tiger habitat is decreasing, or prey population is decreasing, how can that be true? And if you continue to put roads, railways, canals, electricity lines, and mines into our protected areas, how can our wildlife and biodiversity thrive? I mean, can you and me survive without our homes? Can you and me survive without food 3 times a day and clean water to drink and so on, or even electricity? These are the resources we depend on. And without a habitat, without a home, nature or biodiversity is not going to survive. So for me, the simple metric is, are habitats ecologically functional? Is the ecological integrity maintained? Is connectivity maintained? Because you and me can build highways and flyovers and take a plane or whatever to move. Animals and all forms, including things that fly. If you put a glass fronted huge skyscraper, that's a trap for insects and birds. I mean, the hundreds of thousands of insects and birds that get killed because of huge glass fronted skyscrapers is not a joke. So even aerial moving of forms of life can get affected by the way we have had an impact. And definitely animals that have to move on land are incapable of crossing many of the barriers that we put, and including on water. When we build dams, fish which have habitats that they need to access downstream and upstream are not able to do that. Aquatic mammals are not able to do that. Freshwater turtles are not able to do that. And we sometimes even get into the sea. We build all kinds of stuff to build harbors and so on. And just the act of lighting a beach can upset the nesting ecology of sea turtles, which have to come to shore to nest. So there are a zillion ways in which we are impacting. And if my simple plea is, do not focus merely on numbers. Numbers is a good thumb rule to have, but numbers doesn't tell the full story.
Okay, I understand. So what is the, is there an authority that monitors or regulates this? Has it been proactive in...
Go on.
Yeah, has it been proactive in the last, say, 30, 40 years, you would say?
Well, our understanding of biodiversity, wildlife, the impacts we are having, the kind of interventions we need to make are all still in the growth phase, so to say. India has made tremendous advances since around the time in the early 80s that I got interested in such things. I mean, when I got into this field, you could count the number of such people probably just using your two hands. Now we're dealing with dozens of young people getting into this field every year. There are dozens of institutions which offer master's courses. But the disjunct is really between the role academia, civil society, and the government has to play, and especially local communities have to play. We increasingly are having conservation approaches which exclude people, which is a problem. We increasingly are having false debates thrown at us that conservation is an impediment to development. So those are the kind of debates that we need to really engage with. But to straightforward answer your question, this is primarily a state subject. The chief wildlife warden and the state wildlife biodiversity, state biodiversity boards are discharged with that responsibility. At the central level, you have the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, and then you have the National Biodiversity Authority. But whether they're doing a good enough job, yes, certain charismatic species like elephants and tigers and lions get counted often every 4 or 5 years. Bulk of our species, including some of our very, very endangered species, are not. But I will refer to the 2013 Supreme Court judgment on the lion translocation, where they have a wonderful, far-sighted ruling, which unfortunately has not yet been translated 7 years after the judgment, which says that we ask the government of India to put in place a framework for periodically assessing the conservation status of all biodiversity of India. The tragedy is, even today, we don't even know the number of species that occur in India, forget their status. And in many cases, we might even be losing certain species which have limited distribution in the country. So we have plenty to go, plenty to do, plenty to go in terms of addressing the question you asked.
Okay, on that note, let me switch speakers and address Lakshmikant. What are the chief roles of the awareness committee, Karnataka state level awareness committee? Can't hear you.
Muted.
Yeah. Now it's audible now. Okay. Yeah. So now actually from Karnataka State Pollution Control Board, so they have the roles and responsibility of the awareness committee would be like, so they have some scheduled programs for throughout the year. So like World Earth Day, World Environment Day. So then I'm conducting eco-friendly Ganesha workshops, then ozone layer protection, then national recycling week, that is for the e-waste, plastic, SWM, hazardous waste management. So then for the batteries, so then they will also celebrate World Forest Day, so World Water Day, so then cleaning up the rivers, lakes, and other water bodies. So then also biomedical waste management. So then the Green Jatha. So these are all the 18 programs like scheduled. So which will be done throughout the state. So like since Karnataka State Pollution Control Board having 44 regional offices across the state.
Okay. Commonly people understand pollution levels and associated with increasing traffic, right? Okay. Are there any major other contributors to pollution, air pollution?
Actually air pollution means like people all the time thinking that once you talk about the pollution means especially air pollution, so immediately our mind goes to industries only. But there are other major factors like which also contribute for the air pollution, like even from the dust. Like I think you know that we are talking about construction and debris waste. So from that only, that is actually we are having a major air pollution measures for the today. So apart from that, other this thing, I'm not saying that from the vehicles and other things, but this is also one of the major contributor for the air pollution in the city.
Okay, then as a regulatory body, has the Pollution Control Board been enforcing laws uniformly and effectively across the city? Would you say that? Does it have any limitations? Is it fund crunched or is it...
No, actually there is nothing like a fund crunch. So now actually since they are having many labs for the throughout the state, central labs, and we are having in Mysore, Gulbarga, and then Mangalore and other places, so they are doing well. There is no issue with the fund because Karnataka State Pollution Control Board, so they are not receiving even a single rupee from the government. So actually they are running from the cess collected from the various industries. So that is the reason every year they are giving even three CR or four CR to the CM relief fund. So there is nothing financial crunch. So every district have been earmarked for one mission. So it cost nearly 95 lakhs. I think it was imported. So face by face they are doing. So it's true that still they are having some issues, but compared to others for some 5-6 years of this thing, now they are in a good position to monitor the air pollution levels.
Okay. Recently, we have seen these photographs, right? In the post-shutdown situation, there are these photos of clean rivers and all the lakes inside Bangalore also flowing blue and nice.
Okay.
So suggesting that everybody was staying home, the industries had shut down. So clearly that was a cause of their frothing and the muck that was collected. And yet we have known as members of Apartment Federation that there have been many instances of arbitrary action against them.
Correct.
So what triggers these actions?
So let me clarify that. I am not a staff of the Karnataka State Pollution Control Board. So since I am also an activist this thing. So that is the reason I am into this various group, BET, SWMRT, etc. Since I am also staying close to Rishabhavati River, I stay close to Bangalore University campus. I know all these issues from my student life.
Sure.
So it's true that I mean, since the industry has shut down, they're monitoring these things. So, pollution level is reduced. It's true. So now it started. So again, many of the industries are running without consent. So we will come to if you say about the plastic industries. They will run only in the night time. So if you see the daytime is it will be closed shutter. So there are such industries, and moreover Karnataka State Pollution Control Board, so they are right now they are having very less strength of officers. So okay. Though they are having statewide or 44 regional officers in the state, so number of technical staffs are very less. So especially for the last year, so most of the seniors are retired. Since it is a government body, so government has to take, government means not pollution control board, government of Karnataka, government. So they have to recruit some more people. In our state only, hundreds of people who have studied environment science, environment technology, many people are there. So no need to seek for the thing. So that recruitment is not happened. So actually it is in the process. So maybe if they recruit more people, I think we will, come to know more such cases.
Okay. I would again switch speakers now and move to Seema. Seema, first of all, congratulations on your book. It's been a bestseller, Cities and Canopies. You co-authored it with Harini. What prompted you to write this account?
We've been working on the ecology and environment of Bangalore, mainly through our research and academic work. And if we write something about our research, in order to raise awareness, it's quite difficult because the papers that we write are peer reviewed, they're published in a certain journal. They are picked up by will be read by the people who review it by us, and it's maybe by my co-authors. And if I inflict it on my students, some 20 of them will read it. So what we wanted to know was, how do we write something about ecology, about nature, that can appeal to a wider audience? So we were looking at trying to communicate science with a larger public. And we realized that the kinds of books that are there out there on trees talk about some aspects. They talk about either the religious links, or they could be deeply academic books which talk about environmental values. And one of the things we noticed is there are very few written by women. So when we started writing this book, we wanted to incorporate all the different kinds of, the different perspectives, the different ways in which people relate to nature and to trees. And that's why we wrote something that people could pick up. So the book is about 22 chapters. They're very short chapters. So we aimed it at an audience that will be able to pick it up, read one chapter, put it down, think about it, not reading it at one stretch. So that was one of the main reasons. How do we communicate science and increase the audience for of nature lovers?
Great, that's nice. You and Harini have also jointly proposed the creation of a national urban employment guarantee program, especially for small, mid-sized towns and cities. Could you give us an example of an employment under this, and how especially will it favor urban ecology? What sort of jobs would make this happen?
Just a small background, that this urban employment guarantee scheme was developed by the Center for Sustainable Employment, along with Amit, which Amit Basole, Matthew, and all are a part of, Rajendran, they are all a part of this group. And we were looking, they approached us to see what kind of green jobs are possible in cities. So if you want to address issues of employment, economy, and ecology in cities, then one of the ways we were looking at is what kind of jobs that would help in this process. So the job scheme itself has two kinds of employment. One is the daily wage, just like the NREGA has, and the others are apprenticeships for 3 months. These are for graduates, postgraduates who have finished their education and have not immediately got a job, but these 3 months could help them in getting some experience. So the kind of jobs that we looked at in terms of the daily wage are, we looked at the different ecological spaces in cities. They include obviously the obvious lakes, parks, or even some of these groves, like in Bangalore, they're known as, in Karnataka, they're known as Gundutops, as well as other spaces such as under flyovers, you know, near bus stands where there's a lot of these buffer areas that are kept. So these were the kind of spaces, and we were wondering what kind of work, to list out the kind of work, we've actually given 8 pages of the different kinds of work. So for lakes, it would be regular weeding, city silting, there's tree planting, maintenance of trees, because after every rain, there is a huge tree fall. And one of the main reasons for it is lopping of trees, or the trimming of trees is not done regularly. And so we've given it not just for a city like Bangalore, but coastal cities, as well as cities located on hill slopes. So there are a list of different kinds of ecological spaces and the different kinds of works you can do on it throughout the year. That's for the daily wage. Now for the apprenticeship, we looked at what kind of monitoring and evaluating works can people do at the ward level. So suppose there is one ward and there are several issues of water, sanitation. So how can we use the apprenticeship to ensure that there's a continuous monitoring of the environment in a ward, so that it can feed into decision making at the ward level about what they want to prioritize for environment in their budgets or in their plans.
Okay. Trees, every now and then we've seen the administration pull out the jacks and make way for a road or a bridge or something, right? Are there any guidelines that say that you must conserve urban ecology? And if that's so, who's the authority, again, that's expected to enforce?
So as Ravi was saying, there are these acts and there are bodies, ministries and different agencies that are in charge of looking at the implementation of the different environment rules. But at the state level, specifically for trees, you will have something like the Karnataka Tree Protection Act, which specifies what kind of trees, when you can cut them, what is the procedure for it. So if you're looking at municipality like BBMP, there is usually a tree authority whose permission you have to take, you have to submit saying that, you know, these are the trees, the reasons why you want to cut, there has to be an inspection that has to be done by a tree authority. All this is there. So there are these procedures and laws that are available. Each state has will have their own tree protection acts.
Okay. Coming back to Ravi, has the pandemic changed anything for better or worse?
Better or worse for?
Biodiversity.
Definitely there is, bats have a PR problem. Bats are being viewed as the cause of the pandemic, mystifying for me, because it's really what we did. It's not even established that it is bats and that there was an intermediary host. These are still research under process, but given the nature of disruption of our lives, the rumors and the half-truths seem to find more traction than facts. So it does cause a problem. We're doing our best to allay the fears. The government at the highest levels has done its best. The principal scientific advisor has gone on television to allay fears. So there has been an attempt to push back on that. But the other part of the story is that there seems to be, and these are reports, I'm not sure how authentic they are, seems to be some increase in poaching. I don't see the connection between pandemic and increase in poaching, but several reports are there in the media. I don't know how much to trust that. Of course, there is this whole thing about how the pandemic has given a second lease of life for the environment and nature. That, I think, in some sense is a false narrative. It doesn't, and it shouldn't take this level of suffering for us to gain access to quality environment. Why should it be a struggle for every human being to have access to clean air and clean water? What is life about, or what is development about, if people can't have these two basic necessities, clean air, clean water? I mean, what else? I mean, we breathe so many times every minute. And every few hours we need water. So our whole imagination and perception for what is development has to change. And it shouldn't take such a disruption for us to gain access to it. There are, of course, stories of animals coming back in rivers and lakes and even onto the streets of urban situations and so on. Some of it is fake news. Some of it is true, partially true at least. Again, we don't know the circumstances under which these stories are. Mr. Pratik, you might want to mute your microphone. You'll have to mute your microphone.
Yeah, there's some noise from your end. Yeah,
some vehicle sound.
Yeah, thank you. For instance, there was the story of a civet. It was a small Indian civet, which was then said to be the most endangered Malabar civet and all of that. It was probably an animal which was in captivity, which had been released. But that was then positioned as a wildlife regaining its space and so on and so forth. So it is still a mixed and murky kind of situation out there. But one thing for sure, the tourism pressure is definitely not in the tourist zones of our national parks and wildlife sanctuaries. Typically in the more popular areas, anything from 25 to 50 vehicle loads of people go every morning and every evening. That the animals and the environment itself, I mean, because these vehicles go means dust and tailpipe pollution, all of that would be there. So that's not happened. But then there's an economic cost related to it. So it's not an easy answer to give you, Sonia.
Okay. Coming back to Lakshmikant.
Yeah.
In the post-COVID world, do you see any new challenges to the board in terms of, I mean, something like biomedical waste generation? What are we going to do with all the mountain of masks that people are going to now generate? Any challenges that you foresee?
There is nothing like new challenges because type of waste are now going to be different. I mean, if you see the quantity. So earlier, especially during the lockdown period, people, hardly people used to, I can't say hardly, but still more people are using, ordering food from the outside. So that is actually, it generates solid waste that is there. And if you talk about the medical waste, means it's true. Now, what you are watching in the TV, number of positive cases and all. So we are seeing only number of positive cases in the COVID, but we are not getting the information in the TV or some other through the sources that how many people are quarantined, so many other places. Some of the places, it's all packed. We think that hotels and some other places are empty. If you're saying in the TV, one district is 10, 15 COVID cases, means more than 6,000 to 7,000 should be quarantined in hotels and other places. Yeah. So it's true that especially the hotel, if you say, means in hotel, I think BBMP is already, should must we are also doing a lot of campaign that you should not use plastic things. Yeah. So now they have already given a green signal. BBMP already given a green signal for the single use. Things for the food,
yeah,
supply for the quarantine people. So that is actually big challenges for them. So then apart from that, biomedical, this thing is compared to earlier days. Now generation of waste is biomedical is also increased. Drastically increased. So, there is nothing a new challenge. It's as usual, this thing only. So, no, only thing is in this COVID-19, usually pollution control board officer never used to be assigned any other, apart from pollution aspects. So, they're not used to take, government never used to take them for any other work. But now they have taken for this COVID, this thing, even for the night shifts. So, that is it. So, there is nothing new challenges for the board, in handling the especially waste as such.
Okay, so it has to probably do its job better or be more strict. Coming back to you, Seema, if trees have to keep up with the oxygen demand of the growing population, what would you say is the estimate of number of trees that we need to plant yearly? What's a good number?
So
Bangalore is
I don't really know, and that's again like again I go back to what Ravi says, this is a question of just numbers, and maybe the focus should, we should again move away from this idea of numbers. See, the thing is that the trees are not just giving us oxygen, right? There are a whole lot of services that trees provide.
Yeah.
And we need to retain a certain amount of green cover as a city, which the percentage is again debatable. I might say 50%, somebody else might say 5%, 10%. But the point is that, and you know, one of the arguments that somebody wrote to us when we about the book was that the maximum oxygen in the world is produced by algae. It's not really trees. So on those grounds, maybe the production of oxygen cannot be the only reason to preserve trees. So we are arguing for tree protection for a variety of reasons. One is that, yes, it produces oxygen and it does it for free. Second is for the many services that what we term as ecosystem services that trees provide. It's absorption of noxious gases like sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxide, for settling of dust particles that help to reduce vehicular pollution. Then there are so many people who have cultural and religious associations with trees. So whenever we look at nature, we have to look at it in terms of the multiple uses that it has. And indiscriminate planting of trees is also not a great idea. Like it is being suggested by many people, because trees also have an ecology. Trees also have to be planted very carefully in certain spaces. For example, if you're planting in a city, we should be very careful that while a ficus may be a good species to have and has a lot of benefits, it's not the best kind of species to plant in a narrow road. At the same time, it doesn't mean that you don't plant any trees. So planting of trees also has to be done with some degree of care. There are some systems where maybe if you look at historically how Bangalore's landscape was, it's a very dry, deciduous region. It did not have the kind of tree cover that is there now. But that doesn't mean that we cut all the trees either. So tree planting has to be done with a lot of care. But one of the first things we need to do is to stop cutting trees that are already there, because the value that a grown tree provides is so much more higher than what a sapling that we plant. We may plant a million saplings today, but the kind of value that a grown tree has is so much more than what a sapling may have. We should plant thinking of the future, but not indiscriminately plant. Carefully plant, keeping species in mind, keeping the location, keeping the area.
So again, in the post-COVID world, do you think people will be more environment friendly now, or is 70 days too short a time to learn?
I think if you're going by the news reports, we don't seem to have learned much, because the metro was already, they've already started cutting for the metro. And we are also, I don't know when we will learn. I mean, this consciousness has to come from, it's there in the laws, the legal protections are there, but 70 days, definitely not enough. And I don't know if 100 days will also be enough for this, because this constant binary of development and environment has always favored development. Until we change the way of thinking, that thinking, 70 days, 100 days, 150 days of COVID is not going to change the way things are. Actually, now the push is to have development saying that wages have been affected, the economy needs to recover. There's no emphasis being put on the environment. And while the COVID was going on, there were so many environmental clearances that were given quietly by the Ministry of Environment and Forests. Unacceptable.
Yeah.
And also, in addition to that, Srimad is saying, I heard that even from the during the COVID-19 lockdown, so many clearances from the wildlife this thing have been given without even their consent.
Yeah. It is, it's just been taken as an opportunity
Exactly.
Yeah. So I don't think we learn, because many of us, those who are taking these decisions, are so buffered by its impacts. The people who are going to face the impacts of this are not at all being considered in the decision making, arbitrary decision making.
That's sadly true, yeah. So I have a common, from my side, I have a common last question to all the panelists. In summary, would you say we need to implement the existing laws better, or do we need new laws?
India probably has the best set of environmental and wildlife laws internationally.
Oh.
And the biggest breaker of these laws is the government. And the biggest illiterate community about these laws is the judiciary. So you have a capacity problem to begin with. You have an attitude problem, an approach problem. Laws are only as good as they're implemented, and our implementation track record over the decades, to put it mildly, stinks. So I don't think merely passing more laws is going to resolve any issue. Fundamental changes have to take place, and that fundamental change is in recognition of the environment, nature, as assets. Assets that we need to learn to work with, and not claim that the destruction of these assets is the path of development. That if that doesn't change, and if we can't think long term, I wonder how we are able to pay all the costs that for 3 or 4 months that the society has had to pay, the government has had to pay. I mean, if these had been proactively invested in, within quote, sustainable green growth, it would have been a much smaller cost. I mean, let's not take the specific way case of COVID-19, because primarily the disease originated from outside. But we've been lucky. We have Kaisanur forest disease. We've had a Nipah thing. We have swine flu. And let's again not forget, on a daily basis, more Indians are dying due to other causes than COVID-19. Endemic things like dysentery, TB, all of that is killing people, and it just doesn't make the headlines. It doesn't disrupt. Unlike COVID, there are class and other societal barriers. So it doesn't normally affect people like you and me. It doesn't make headline news. Politicians don't think about it often, because it's politicians, bureaucrats, and middle class and above normally are, above a certain development parameter, which doesn't expose them to these diseases. The one good thing out of COVID is it has made all of us come on the same level, more or less. I mean, the migrant story is, of course, a horror story there. But it has demonstrated between countries, between societies, between class, between geographies, there is nobody who can escape it. The Prime Minister of UK had it. So that is a great leveler. But let us not think that laws are going to change anything, because we just, and our legal system also, the wheels of our legal system grind so slowly. The unfortunate thing is, even in these laws, we are seeing a very systematic way of diluting, undermining. And as both Seema and Lakshmikant mentioned, in April, there were meetings which were online meetings, which are clearing projects, which involved public consultation and field visits, both of which are not possible. The online meeting was only for 2 hours, which is typically a face-to-face meeting would last at least a day. So, you know, the writing is on the wall. I mean, it's always been there. It is just being reinforced now. And it's all about ease of doing business, whatever that means. Environment is seen as an impediment. We just want online clearances. It's a checkbox. So I don't think getting more serious laws or getting more laws is the answer. Do we as citizens want a more sustainable environment? Do we as citizens want a better implementation of existing laws? We cannot leave it to anybody else. We as citizens deserve the government we get, because we don't hold them accountable. I think that is the nature of relationship that needs to change, rather than bring a whole set of new laws.
Others, what do you feel, Lakshminkant and Seema?
Ravi Chalam sir's statement. So there are anyway many laws in our country. So only the question is with the implementation from the regulating authorities. Implementation means who is going to implement, who is going to make the law, and who is going to implement. So the people are implementing the laws itself, they are not obeying the laws. So that is the biggest problem in our country. So like small, I will give you a small example. See, High Court has given order that as far as this waste segregation is concerned, like everyone should be segregated at their home. So how many officers are segregating in the first place before they are selling to others? So I mean, these are all the basic questions. They're like in BBMP, so every week or every other meeting, so they keep we keep discussing about the segregation. So how many officers so they are segregating at their home in the first place before they are teaching and expecting segregation at the house level from the layouts. So these are all the like typical issues. So that's why I keep saying my association with pollution control board is more than 10 years since I was studying from my environmental science PG. So I keep saying even in the many groups I keep saying that, so don't simply pose your problems. Okay, we know that everyone is having a problem with a different thing. So you just I keep saying that like you can come. So I can take you to the consent officer. I know many officials over there. I can take you there. You just discuss with them and settle the matter. So like without doing so, they keep on complaining. They think it doesn't end up anywhere. So and especially like and I missed one answering your question. Like as far as the STP issues are concerned, so it is not a big issue. See, STP means like now so many types of STPs have come. So earlier only conventional is there. So now so many technologies. So there are many, technologies. They are also importing from the other countries. So once once they install, so they will. It is a responsibility of the, especially for the, owners. So to check that whether that is the, whether the limit, whether once they are going for that, giving the lab report, whether it is well within the permissible limit. That's all. That is the only thing. So without that one, so like when the officers will come for the inspection, so they will just take the samples and this thing. And now actually you don't have to blame anyone. Earlier, so there was nothing like private labs. So whatever the report you are getting from the pollution control board, that is a final. See, now there are like many NABL lab reports. Okay, chalo, let them take one sample. You can also take one sample, get it tested, and you can always question them. So there is nothing like hide and seek now. It's open for all. Unlike earlier, like people used to say that no. See, once you are slapping the notice means so like that is the final. So now the things have changed. So you can always question them. Now I think more number of cases are filed against pollution control board and many NGOs and even in NGTs, even in Apex courts. So those days again, like even now people are questioning for the last 1 year, so board has seen so many chairmen because of this issues only. But earlier chairman, so people used to ask, I can witness that many NGOs used to come to their office and even demand chairman for the revoking some industries. So like that, it always happens. You cannot sit at home or like you cannot sit at office, or we cannot just keep on chit-chatting in the WhatsApp or Facebook or in webinars or discussing about this thing. And you should, my suggestion is you should always interface with the officers and discuss. And if there is any issues, means you can just lodge a complaint. If you are at no fault, you can always demand. So I don't think much laws are more laws are required. Adding that one now, so there is one law called CRZ, coastal regulation zone notification. Okay, hardly people knows that. When I was a student, third year BSc student, just my curiosity, we have traveled all the Karnataka coastal, say 320 kilometer stretch. We have documented the violations. So like we can engage students like that. There are many things. Sir, I feel that as of now, there are many less. So only the thing is with the implementation part.
Seema, would you concur that we have enough laws?
I would say that we have more than enough laws. But there are two things I want to say. One is that when it comes to implementation, implementation is extremely poor, there's also a huge inequity even in the way it is done. For example, if a farmer or a tribal cuts a block of wood, that becomes a huge environmental violation. But the violations that are done by industries are completely ignored, which are at a much massive scale. And the second is also the way the idea of development that is being presented. So it's like a survey, where a consumer survey, where you are given three choices for a product you have bought. do you like, are you satisfied with the product? Highly satisfied, moderately satisfied, satisfied, which is in a sense that there is no negative that you can give. So the choices that in environment that the government gives are, do you want the road or you don't want the road? If you want the road, you're pro development. If you don't want the road, you're pro, you're anti development. So this is the kind of rhetoric also that is causing a lot of problems, because you're not even thinking imaginatively about how you can bring development and environment together. So there is implementation, there's also communication about development that is a huge problem right now.
Thank you, all the panelists. I'd like to invite questions from the others now. Okay, I'll just read out the ones that are already in the chat window and then we can ask more new questions. Ram Ramaswamy has asked, how has the green cover in Karnataka, how is it now? And what is a good level considering our size? I think she sort of touched upon it earlier. He's also asking a related question. TN Session energized the Election Commission. How do we get such a movement in this area?
I will answer the second part and leave it to the other panelists to maybe touch on the first one. This is not going to be done by an individual. I think environment touches each of our lives. Expecting a top-down solution is unrealistic and undesirable also. I think in our culture, in our ways of living, nature is integral in many ways, but that is seen often as old-fashioned, and official conservation policies are driving a wedge between nature and people, saying that wildlife can only survive if people are moved out of wildlife habitats, not recognizing the fact that these people have been living there for centuries, if not decades, before any of those protected areas were created. So I think more emphasis on site-specific conservation models, more emphasis on inclusive conservation models, more emphasis on not diluting justice. Justice is non-negotiable. You cannot place conservation at a higher plane than human rights. If there are laws protecting human rights, conservation has to comply with those laws. Very often the false argument is made, we have 1.2 billion people, but we have only 3,000 tigers. So if a few people get affected to save a few tigers, that is acceptable. That clearly is not acceptable. That argument cannot and should not stand in a court of law. So to me, the way to do it is not a top-down approach. The way to do it is by energizing, by organizing, by networking, by supporting and ensuring justice at the grassroots level.
So maybe I can do the how has the green cover in Karnataka improved? That is, so I don't have the figures, but I do remember reading an article in end December or Jan that said that the forest cover of Karnataka had increased by, I think, around 1,000 or 1,200 square kilometers. Now, that is not really a cause for celebration, because if you look into the fine text of it, it says that it is because the forest department had done a lot of plantation. Now, the question is, what are the kind of trees that have been planted? Normally, plantation drives are done using some species like eucalyptus or acacia. So this is a case where, and if you look at any of the forest survey, every year the forest survey reports keep saying that the forest cover is increasing. I mean, that's absurd, because there's so much of destruction that is happening. It's quite impossible that the cover can increase. So the cover is increasing because of these plantations, which are really not forests in the true sense. These are mainly exotic species. They have very little biodiversity. Meanwhile, huge acres of forest land, prime forest land, is cut for, say, things like mining or, you know, those kind of development projects. So we have to be very cautious again, going back to the idea of numbers, about when we celebrate that we have increased 1,200 square kilometers. It's the question we need to ask is, how did that happen? What are the species that were planted? Where did this happen? Who's benefiting from it? Like Ravi said, justice is very critical. We shouldn't focus so much just on the numbers again.
More question from Sanjay. If we cut trees for development, can't the trees be transplanted? Is it possible to transplant?
There have been experiments of transplanting. Even Bangalore has done it, but it's very, very expensive. So one of the cases that got a lot of press was the transplantation of some of the huge banyan on Sarjapur Road. And each tree transplantation cost about 6 lakhs. And at the end of it, if you look at that tree where it has been transplanted, it's not really thriving in that sense, you know, not like the tree that would have been there where it was growing originally. So transplanting is really not such a great option. It's expensive and yeah.
There's one other question by Soumya. How does the Environment Impact Assessment Act of 2020 that's about to be introduced affect the urban development? Is there anything that is being done for setting up of STP in urban areas? Perhaps this is for Lakshmikant.
As far as the STP is concerned, I just mentioned earlier that. So now earlier STPs means when you see the urbanizations. So earlier STPs means BWSSB STPs and hardly few, associations of STPs are there. So now things have changed that even industry after the industrial revolution. So there is something called even common effluent treatments and CETPs. So then common even STP plants. So things have such things are now they are introducing. And government is also keen in that. And they have also sanctioned huge amount of money. So we don't know when they are going to start up, because as you know, government will say if you say today means it will take years together to implement. So that is the issue. We need to just see how they are going to implement in the future. So we need to just see, watch. Yeah, there is, I think, one more question for me.
Can we as individuals engage better with $1 million question?
That is actually $1 million question, sir. So, you are asking about the awareness drives, right?
Sorry, awareness drives as well as you said that it's when you go actually hold an officer accountable, talk to him and
correct yeah,
so as individuals, yeah. How do we
correct exactly see as an individual means if you have any issues you can always shoot a mail means as a formality you can just send a mail every day. They keep receiving thousands of mails. I don't think they'll read. So just for formal setting, you can just shoot on mail and you just come and meet that concerned officer. So if you just log into KSPC website, so you will come to know which zone you belong to. You can just check the jurisdiction of the area. So then you can meet the officers. I have all officers' numbers are there. You can just meet them, tell your problem. In case if you are not the same, if your problem is not solved, then you can always, there is an authority in the MS building. So you can just complain to them if you are not, your problem is not issue, you are not resolved.
Thank you.
And apart from that, as far as this awareness programs are concerned, I don't know how many people are knowing. Because awareness means whatever we are seeing in the Bangalore only will be reflected in the media and other these things. So in even other districts also many things are happening. So even if they are from the outside the Bangalore also they can engage. So if they can contact their regional offices, so they can just get if they are running, for example, if somebody is running an NGO, so they can just tie up with the pollution control board and celebrate and conduct their programs. So that is there. And apart from that, they're also giving, for each program, they'll be giving 10,000 rupees for the NGOs. So since 3 years, I keep sending message in the WhatsApp group, none of them turned up. But except that, so they ask all other 100 questions.
Yeah, I think you as officials, citizens ask for officials' engagement. Officials are also seeking citizens to engage.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah. Very true.
Waste streaks, I think. Any further questions? I don't see any on the chat window. Would anybody like?
Yeah, I would want to go forward.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, so now that you said that the laws are enough, the judiciary is there, has some sort of taken action as well. However, what is the way forward for citizens of Bangalore for sustainable development as well as the recovery of a green cover? Now, this could be any percentage, but still a recovery of the green cover in terms of how Bangalore can get back to its previous form. Right? What is the way forward? This could include citizens' involvement, how we can engage more officials to citizen-official engagement, and also the judiciary.
Hey.
What is the way forward? Yeah. Any three of you could take this.
You cannot view green cover in isolation. Because, one, the city has grown to whatever size it's grown, and it's followed a particular development path. So, one is to undo the damage. The other is to ensure no further damage. So the engagement has to be at the annual planning, development. And that really is the hard thing. We often don't get sufficient advance notice. Public consultations are a sham. I mean, we've had that steel flyover issue keep coming back after it's been, we thought, dead and buried. So it is going to take a lot of active engagement. And this is going to require thousands of people allocating time. Unfortunately, most of us will not get paid to do this. It'll have to be voluntary time. We'll have to be smart about it. We'll have to bring a coalition of skills to the table, including communication, campaigning, research. You might think I'm waffling and not giving you a clear-cut answer. The fact is, there is no simple, you have a fever, take Prozen, tomorrow you'll be fine. These kind of issues are complex, messy, multiple pathways, and there is never a confirmed victory. You might think, oh yeah, that problem is out of the window. 2 years or even 1 year down the line, for whatever reason there are vested interests, the same problem resurfaces. So we just have to remain engaged, a lot of optimism with a strong dose of realism, and the energy has to come. So we have to keep recruiting more and more people, especially younger generation, to view this as part of our life in the city. If we want our city to take a particular form, we have to help shape it, not blame others, not throw up our hands and say, this is beyond us.
And if I can add, one of the best ways now, because we have the 74th Amendment, is to get more involved at the ward level with each of our wards and demand what we think is ecologically suitable for the wards. And yes, like Ravi says, that we have to get out there and protest. So the steel flyover was dead and buried, we thought. But now, just before the COVID lockdown, we did an environmental impact assessment of the outer ring road. So steel flyover, they said around 2,000 trees are going to be cut. The outer ring road, more than 8,000 trees are going to be cut. And nobody even knows about this because this is not in the middle of the city. It is happening somewhere, Jigni, Attibele, Anekal, Banergata, and the road is cutting through the Anekal Reserve Forest, which is contiguous to Banergata National Park. So all this is happening around us. And the only way is that we have to step out there and say that this is not what we want. And actually protest. And that's why this COVID situation is now going to have a huge impact on citizen protests, because you're going to say that you can't come together and protest because of the social distancing issues. So this might be taken as an kind of an excuse to not hold public consultations. The EIA that somebody mentioned, 2020, that the draft EIA is a complete dilution of the already existing laws. So we now can't even depend on our good laws if they're going to be diluted. Judges are also very fickle. Fortunately, right now, Karnataka has a good judge. It's a good time to put all the cases, maybe. But the only way is if people come and demand what they want for a city in terms of the environment.
Yeah, just adding to both of them. So, yeah, like as far as these statistics are concerned, so like as Seema Madam was mentioning that, so we'll go by the statistics all the time. Like people will say that, no, we have planted some 4 CR, 5 CR and all. Just to add that one, so we had last year, no, not last year, before last year, we had a World Environment Day celebration. So when Siddaramaiah was the Chief Minister, so he was just asking on the stage in front of 10,000 audience, more than 10,000 audience in the GKVK campus. Like every year you keep saying that 1 crore implanted, so 3 crore planted, 4 crore planted. So in, this is my fourth year as a CM, but I have not seen anyone. Do you really think that? So those many crores of plantation has been done from your department. So this is a situation. I mean, if people will say that, like as Ravi sir mentioned that, okay, the five CR as per the forest department record. So who is going to see that whether five CR is there or only 500s are there? So the so this is like, I mean, I think we should not rely on more of a statistics. So like as Seema was mentioning that, so this COVID is a big, I mean, excuse for the so protests and other things. So that is the reason. So I think for the green cover, I think from the individual level, we need to do what our ward level better. So that's my just suggestion adding to that.
I mean, it's people. We are the ones who are in a ward and we can see instantly when something is happening. We don't have to wait for the government or the corporator and hire, say, your MP or the MLA to take it. The reason we have the strength is because we are the eyes on the ground, eyes and feet on the ground. So we should be doing that, being the watchdog for the environment.
But in some sense, despite the social distancing norms or physical distancing norms, I mean, you've seen what's happening around the world in the last few days for Black Lives Matter. So, I mean, if you really want to do it, we can still do it.
Yeah, that's true.
On that note of...
Thank you very much.
...having the freedom of expression, I would like to thank the panelists and the participants for a very interactive session. I hope we do better and I hope we do the right by all the factors that we've just learned today to consider.
Could we reach out to the panelists at some point, as in if we have their email addresses and we want to run something, as in seek suggestions or see if we're taking actions in the right path, could we write to the panelists at some point?
I'm just putting my email ID.
Do that on the chat window. Thank you.
Lakshmikant, bye Seema. Bye everybody.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, we'll meet sometime.
Thank you, Lakshmikant.
Bye. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. For Lakshmikant.
Everyone get the addresses? Lakshmikant, I think you haven't typed.
I am just typed now. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's done.
Thanks, everyone. Good
Thank
evening.
Thank you. Thank you. Very good.
76. I done.